been more wrong about all of this. I'm not quite sure what time I'll be home. Maybe around 7 or 8 tonight.
I was telling you about this filming thing that we've got going on.
Yeah.
You know, I was telling you, they do these internal communication things at the space agency. Anyway, they asked me if they could sort of have a day in the life. They want to do a day in the life of some of the senior members of the agencies.
I'm not, so how does this work? Are you guys rolling now, or?
Yeah, that's why they're here. Hello, everybody. Welcome to our home. This is my lovely daughter, Mary.
Hi.
She's a good girl. She's at university. And she's very smart, like her mom.
Is it like going on telly?
Mm-mm. We're not going on telly. No, it's just for internal communications. It's so they have a kind of resource.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, right, okay. Okay, I'm gonna change.
All right, sweetie.
Okay, okay.
See you in a bit. She's a bit shy. Can I get you guys a coffee or a tea or?
Well, I mean, obviously, she's incredibly inspiring. I think, especially nowadays, to like have a mum who's the head of, you know, one of the biggest international space agencies. Obviously, my mum's Canadian, but my dad was British. They met at university. Mm-hmm. He was doing a semester. It was very special mum.
The peacekeeper.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't talk about him that much, I suppose, as much as we should.
Oh. I'm really sorry. I think I have to get this. Just, sorry, bear with me one second. Hello? What? You're kidding me. No, I can be there in about 25 minutes or so. Okay, just hang tight. Ask, yeah, get Alex on it. Just tell him. Okay, good, he knows. Yeah, no, just hang tight. I'll be right there, hang on. Okay. I'm so sorry, something has come up. I'm really sorry, I have to go.
ISS, be advised, thermal increase detected in nodes 2 and 3. I repeat, thermal increase detected in nodes 2 and 3.
Permission to attempt comms hardware reboot of node 2.
ISS, please confirm to mission control when you are ready to proceed with the module rack replacement.
3 VA hatch in 3, 2, 1. Unity node, module visibility confirmed.
Copy that, Jim.
Jim to Francois, come in.
We need loud and clear, Jim.
Good, because you owe me big time. Over.
ISS, copy that.
Connecting additional cable harnesses for electrical and data systems rerouting. Fluid lines check confirmed for thermal control.
Copy that, Jim. Data systems routing is good to go.
Copy that. Making my way back to the ISS.
Receiving interference with your last transmission. Can you please repeat?
Can you confirm a strange sound being picked up by our radios?
We don't recognize that frequency band. Please check and confirm if this is a comms breach.
That's a negative. All radio frequency bands are nominal. Whatever that sound is, it's not coming from us. Whoa. Mission control, are you seeing what I'm seeing?
We seem to have lost your video uplink. Please elaborate on your last transmission.
It looks like some kind of solar storm disturbance. Francois, you see this? Jim, I see it. Whatever that is, it's disrupting our communication. Were there any solar storms expected to be coming our way?
That's a negative, Jim. No solar storms have been reported.
It looks like the 4th of July up here right now. Heavy vibrations. I can see it on the panels. Francois, engage the airlock. Airlock engaged. I'm making my way back, but this is so bright, I'm being blinded right now.
Jim, it looks like your tether is becoming unstable. We suggest you use the handle grips to maneuver.
I can feel tension on this thing. I'm going to have to disengage. I got to disconnect this thing if I'm going to get back.
Jim.
I can't see anything. My tether, I can feel it tension. Come in, Jim. Tell me, what do you see? It's my first thing.
It's still not known exactly what caused the power outage on the ISS, but what's complexing is that all of the satellites that were in orbit were affected at the exact same moment as well. Now, of course, the tragic outcome is that astronaut Jim Marcel is currently missing, presumed dead. And it's possible that his tether was disconnected during the incident.
Firstly, I just want to say that I've known Jim for a long time, so obviously it's a very difficult time, but we've got to get on. We've got to find out what happened. We have a lot of footage that's come down from the ISS, and we've got a team now that's going through that frame by frame, and we don't know what it is yet. We do know that it's not a solar flare. We know that it's not an electrical storm.
This isn't the first time that an anomaly has appeared above our planet. We first encountered it in 1990, and it was visible for about 2 months. But before we could get any further data, any meaningful data, it vanished, never to be seen again, until now.
Yep, I'm calling it. Yep, I will have to do something.
Well, basically, when I got the call, I'd been asleep for about 45 minutes. I've been working on a project for the last 8 months, so it's been pretty intense. They wouldn't tell me anything on the phone, space agency protocol, only that it was of a classified nature, which requires my expertise in the field of gravitational waves and space anomalies. The idea that this anomaly is emitting some form of gravitational wave surprised us all, and it was definitely outside anything predicted by science. What could cause such a phenomena? I don't know yet.
This morning, the space agency reported that astronaut Jim Marcel was killed by incoming space debris whilst on a maintenance mission on the ISS. A space agency spokesperson said this is a tragic incident, but Jim Marcel was passionate about his job, and their condolences go to his family.
A name was given to this anomaly. We started calling it the Void, which is way better than anomaly 234-B.
It had the appearance, well, similar to the remnants of a supernova, but due to its proximity to Earth, we knew it was something completely different. But during its appearance, we also detected a short burst radio wave, and the signal was transmitted in a very specific frequency, 1420 megahertz.
This 1420 megahertz frequency, a very strange and complex phenomenon, also known as the hydrogen line. The radio astronomers who first recorded it, they chased their tails trying to find the source of the signal, to no avail. And then it disappeared. All these years later, we're still trying to find the source. Never reoccurred.
If we miss any opportunity to investigate this now, we may have to wait for another 25 years for it to reappear. If it reappears.
And what we need to know is, who put it there? Where did it come from? Is it intelligent? Is it trying to communicate with us? I mean, these are the questions that we need answers to.
So we have reconnaissance probes in orbit to do routine external examinations of spacecraft and satellites in orbit, as well as planetary exploration when the time comes. So I made a call to authorize a probe be sent on a recon mission into the void.
Maneuvering in space isn't quite as simple as it's often portrayed in the movies. To move from one orbit to another takes quite a lot of energy. So we had to adjust the craft's orbit to intersect with that of the void. If something goes wrong here with the probes, that might be it. It might be our only chance to have a look. We always expected to lose communication, just not necessarily that soon. But thankfully, all is not lost. Our probes are fitted with state-of-the-art high-definition cameras that stream directly to our servers here. And even in that briefest of windows, we were able to maintain a signal, and we captured imagery.
As our probe moved closer, we noticed this tunnel-like structure just directly ahead of us. Now, have a look at this light at the center. This is light and cosmic matter entering and leaving. So what we're potentially looking at here is a wormhole. And, you know, we all know that there is an entrance and an exit. So if this is indeed a wormhole, then the next question is, what is on the other side of the void?
It looks like we're dealing with a wormhole. We still need to run more data and have a look over all the images that we've been sent back, just to know exactly what we're dealing with here.
Technically, this is not a wormhole. Well, not in my opinion. In the case of the void, well, we are sure that an entry point exists. We call it the throat. The question is whether a second throat exists, an exit point. Would whatever we send in there emerge the other side, or would it remain stuck there for eternity?
Our finding was a little bit like jumping and looking over a really high wall, but only getting a glimpse of what's on the other side. However, each time you jump, you capture a little bit more information. And what began to emerge for us was a kind of flash frame of what appeared to be a spherical shape in the distance. Now, upon closer examination of this flash frame, we began to see the potential for this spherical shape to be another planet.
We could be looking at first contact with intelligent life. That is a major possibility that we're looking at right now.
Now we have something. Something really big. Perhaps too big. I don't think we're prepared or have the resources to investigate further. I mean, something of this magnitude.
I want to send our astronauts up there. I understand what happened to Jim Marcel. I can appreciate that.
I want to note, Sid, that I flatly object. I cannot support that.
The reality is that we have to get information. How are we going to get it? We can't continue to send probes up there. They don't have the capability. We need to be in communication with somebody on the other side.
Same conversation for the next 2 years. If we miss the window, we miss our opportunity.
Okay.
stage are the probes at? What stage are we at with their development?
We've lost them. They went through, and we have no signal whatsoever. Totally interrupted, totally blacked out.
It says here that so far we've lost a total of 3.5 million in technology with the probes.
It's not a bottom line thing here. We're not talking about a spreadsheet. We're talking about probably one of the most important things that has happened in space exploration. And I think we need to move forward on that. I think we need to move forward now.
Okay. What do you suggest? Our immediate focus is to define this mission. Several ideas were discussed, but nobody's interested in sending more probes. The determination was to finance a full mission. And we were able to raise a large sum of funding, in fact, the largest sum of funding ever raised in the history of space exploration, because the mere glimpse of a potentially habitable planet, well, I have to tell you, that raised an awful lot of interest. Regardless, it was agreed upon to keep this mission classified, for now, a complete media blackout, until we have a greater understanding of what exactly it is we're dealing with. The first step we took was to provide a cover story to the media in order to provide a distraction as part of the media blackout. In time, we will provide full disclosure to the media, but right now, the space agency feels that the public is just not ready to know about the mission involving the void.
This notion of the space agencies to send a human astronaut through to the other side. It's not going to happen. Because physically, we as human beings couldn't possibly endure the extreme stresses that such a venture would entail.
For decades, we've been developing suits to protect our astronauts from the dangers of space. What we're going to need to do now to protect our astronauts from traveling through the void is something, quite frankly, I don't think we have the technological capabilities to do.
As I've implied a few times before, sending a human astronaut would be suicidal. In order to survive a wormhole, he or she would have to endure gravitational waves that would spaghettify them. The only feasible, though problematic, solution would be to use robotics or probes.
What can only be described as a terrifying distortion of clouds.
I think they're doing some kind of project. Maybe they're testing some new weather machine.
It was pulsating with light, kind of.
It's just like, you can see the clouds moving. It's really scary.
We're receiving new data from the void. We weren't expecting this, not so soon.
In recent weeks, our orbiting satellites have been observing the void and collecting as much data as possible. We can see that the void has been emitting a series of invisible waves, and it's this invisible wavelength that has been growing and expanding at a very, very fast rate. And we believe that this activity occurred at the same time as the strange dark orbs that have been appearing in our skies. So we have run this information through our simulator to predict its activity based on what we currently know. The simulation is forecasting a storm of invisible forces, which could consist of dark matter and velocity fields and other unknown fields and waves that we know nothing about. So when this storm reaches us, our planet will be in the midst of what could be a huge cosmic wave. Since the appearance of the black orbs in our skies, each nation's defense department has declared the situation as a global security threat. The Defense Department reached out to us at the space agency. They realized our problem of sending astronauts through the void. They believe they had a solution, and they directed us to their transhumanism division.
Classified technology is a solution. But frankly, I don't think they have another alternative. Within the defense research and tech divisions were classified programs, and they were taking place within the areas of neuroscience, transhumanism, and synthetic biology for advanced soldiers. Now, you see, these programs were classified for the obvious reasons of ethics and were definitely not sanctioned officially by the government as such. Particularly the Human 2.0 program, due to the nature of the technology utilizing the fusion of human cells with synthetic biochemical structures to create a new body powered by the soldier's preserved brain.
The brain can live without a body, but the body can't live without its brain. It's that simple notion which drives the Human 2.0 project. Our aim was to create a prosthesis that could house the human brain, a substitute body. But most importantly, we wanted it to be recognizable as human. Okay, I'm gonna open up the back if you wanna have a look. Okay, so this compartment here is gonna house the brain. And you see the red jelly-looking substance here? So that's actually a coolant gel, and it travels throughout the body, and it houses millions of tiny fiber optic threads connecting the brain right down to all the synthetic muscles and even to the really superficial sensors. But the brain's gonna sit in here, and the gel also acts as a shock absorber. So should the Human 2.0 receive any impact, the gel will dissipate any force protecting the brain. But here, let me show you this, okay. Don't worry, he's not alive. That's just a synaptic nerve reflex. A transplant hasn't been made into this body yet, so essentially it's just a body. It's like a bit like a computer without a hard drive.
In the recent week, we have covertly searched the globe for candidates who are willing to push the barriers of science. Now, officially, the selected candidates will be on a mission to the International Space Station to conduct research. However, once the transplant takes place, they can never return to the lives they left behind. Their families will be informed and will be given an appropriate explanation that will, of course, protect the mission and the space agency. A closed casket funeral will take place to provide closure to the families.
For the record, do you understand the classified nature of this mission and the legal non-disclosure agreements that you sign, which prohibit you from ever discussing this project to anyone outside of this room?
I understand.
And you understand
understand the full nature of this program.
Yes, I'm fully aware.
And what do you feel your strongest asset is that you'd be bringing to this mission?
I'm hoping to bring to this mission my virology expertise.
Military background? And in the short time I've been in the space program, I have risen the ranks faster than anyone in the history of the space program. But you know this.
It's the unknown. It's the possibility of something else out there for us.
Even though there's some pretty scary risks, to know that there's a chance to do so much more.
Well, I think it's in our nature to want to rise above our limits.
I feel that I want to do something great, you know? Like, I want to be like my dad and be remembered for something.
Sir, I've spent the great majority of my life in a chair. Half of my body does not work. I do not want sympathy for that. I have come to terms with that. I've made my peace with that. But sir, for most of my life, I have dreamed of being and doing something more. And part of coming to terms with my situation is resigning myself to the fact that is not something that could happen for me. I will not be the person I thought I could be. What you're doing right now, sir, is presenting me with a chance to fulfill that dream, that desire.
I have cancer. If my body is limiting me, then I need to go beyond that. This is the only way I can do it.
Are you sure that you're aware that this is a one-way ticket? We select not only on a physical prowess, but also on the ability to emote, to be empathetic.
Could I go through with the procedure? There's just too many ethical issues to think about. It would have to be a massive, massive reason for me to go ahead with something like that. And I can't think of one. So no, I couldn't do it.
The subjects would have to pass a series of tests, as well as internal exams from our psychologist and fitness and medical checks. The process in itself is painless. The subject will be administered a cocktail of drugs via IV drips, which will stop the heart for a few hours, simulating a peaceful death. The most time-consuming part is the wiring up, the remapping of the artificial spinal cords connecting to the brain, thus allowing for mind-body communication to function very much like it does in each of us. What you need to understand is it's this fusion process where the brain imprints with the synthetic body and comes together. That's the creation of the human 2.0. That's the marvel. But we must remember, these human 2.0s aren't entirely immortal. The brain also degenerates over a period of time. Now, the difference being that, unlike humans, their bodies last much longer, so the period of life is extended for much longer, but not forever.
The vetting process for the human 2.0 program is extremely high. Basically, these candidates will become ambassadors representing the human race on the other side and are selected based on their extraordinary cognitive abilities. We only have two synthetics available for this program, so the selection process has been extremely critical. We've decided to action the first transplant before making the second selection. For the first transplant, Carl Roberts. He's not as academic, perhaps, as the other candidates, but his cognitive skills are beyond our expectations.
When I opened that bit of paper, it contained the information I wanted it to, and I was accepted. Man, yeah, that is everything I wanted, man. I'm
I didn't know if I had said everything I needed to say in that interview. I can't describe the excitement I feel right now. I mean, I'm gonna get out of this chair. I'm ready. Bring it on.
He has a certain hunger that this requires. It's that sense of adventure that will drive this mission. And we're very, very pleased that he's on board.
Today, I'm having a full body scan to allow the human 2.0 body to be as close to me as possible, warts and all. Apparently, the agents think that if first contact were to be made, then it should be in human form so that the extraterrestrials would know what we look like. It's a good job. I'm so attractive, don't you think?
So the body shell is a breakthrough in nanomaterial technology. It's made of a military-grade graphene, so millions of its tiny fibers woven to make the body shell impenetrable, yet it can also maintain a flexibility, which is important for some areas, such as for the joints. Its eyes use nano-based optics, which allow the retina to adjust to several different lighting conditions. And yeah, you are probably wondering why the human 2.0 is breathing. Well, this is just one of the many features incorporated to help feel more familiar. The breathing effect is actually caused by a mechanism within the synthetic body to help with thermal regulation. A tight regulation of glucose and oxygen metabolism is essential for brain physiology. So we developed a compound called ZO2H, which releases tiny amounts of electrochems into the brain. This compound, essentially, it mimics the properties of glucose and oxygen, therefore fueling the brain and keeping it alive organically.
The original design of the spacecraft was intended for human astronauts, so we've now stripped it bare of any hardware or technology needed for life support systems, as the 2.0 human crew won't need it. Therefore, making it smaller and lighter, which means it's faster and it uses less fuel. They will be jacked into these sockets so that we can monitor their diagnostics. But it also means that we can feed information directly into their cerebral cortex. I mean, that's a remarkable thing, don't you think?
First contact, of course, is of the utmost importance, how it's presented. Concern for us, like, what are we communicating to? And what exactly are we going to discover when we make contact with the intelligent extraterrestrial life form? Are we thinking in terms of a human, perhaps a microbe? It's very, very difficult for us. And so what we've done is we've put together a golden archive drive. This is an upgrade. It has more visuals, more sound, videos. And well, hopefully when we do make first contact, we will be able to communicate all of the images, the sounds, an essence of who we are and our intention.
No, it's good. I'm all right.
Sir?
Thank you.
Hey. Oh. Vitals look good.
Yes, sir, everything works. Waste up.
Have you been made aware of the actual procedure? You can relax.
Thank you.
Have you been made aware of the procedure?
I think so. I think, quite a bit. I don't know.
Okay, well, let me take you through it step by step. The only level of, let's say, uncomfortability that you might experience is just at the very beginning, we need to make an incision just round here to be able to gain access into the spinal cord. You have to look at this as a procedure. Not everything is going to happen straight away. The actual time taken will be around about 3 days. Your awareness begins to fade very slowly. Your heart rate will begin to slow down. As the heart rate slows down, your level of consciousness will actually expand before then beginning to come down.
Okay, so I'll just fade out.
That's one way of being able to. That's one
I go
way
to
of
sleep.
Describe. It's a very peaceful sleep.
All right.
A very peaceful sleep.
I guess this is my last interview before I transplant into the new body. I wanted to go out into space and live there forever among the stars. And he told me that I could do whatever I wanted to do, as long as I put my mind to it. So, this is for you, Dad.
The military have been doing recon flybys to get a closer look at the spheres. Now, what's complexing is that the spheres don't seem to be reacting to us. The space agency has convinced leaders of key nations not to initiate an attack without us analyzing the data to further understand what the spheres are and what is their connection to the void. Our advanced satellite geomapping indicates that the spheres are scattered across the entire globe. Although we don't have an accurate number, it's estimated that there are hundreds of these spheres floating in our skies, with more appearing every day. The geomapping also revealed a pattern within the formation of the spheres. It's as if they are aligning themselves in preparation for something.
At 8:35 this morning, our first human 2.0 transplant attempt failed. And the subject was pronounced dead. There'll be a second attempt, I presume.
I'm devastated. I lost someone who was so supportive of this mission, of this cause. But we're losing time. We have to launch within a week, and we can't afford to lose that window.
Carl's transplant revealed that the brain couldn't fuse with the synthetic body, and it rejected it during the fusion process, and pretty much scrambled the brain synapses so badly that the brain just overloaded.
To prevent another loss, the idea is to update the original synthetic body printing technology with a new integrated tissue organ printing system. Introducing a tiny amount of the subject's actual cells into the synthetic gel means the brain can make the connection with something organic and not freak out when it comes into contact with a foreign body structure it's not used to during the fusion process.
In my professional opinion, this whole thing is being rushed. We need more time. Look, the only way that this could work, the feasibility of it, is to ensure that the human transplant is tested with the enzyme beforehand. We would need to test each candidate. But this would require several months.
We don't have months or even weeks. We're really up against it.
We have the military human 2.0s, we should deploy with them.
Sending one military human 2.0 is one thing, but sending two as a replacement to our astronauts. Well, I think you have to ask yourself, do we want soldiers representing humanity, especially in that state of mind? And I can confidently tell you that that is not something that I am comfortable with. Thankfully, I have been advised by my medical science team that there is a potential solution which would fit in our time frame. Ever since our probes have been sending back samples from the moon mining missions, the Mars rover missions, those samples have been kept in storage in the Space Agency facility. As protocol, we take blood samples and urine samples of all Space Agency staff to monitor any radiation effects coming from the labs. And this protocol is, in part, us keeping our team safe, but also conforming to science and technology workplace regulations.
Out of the entire agency, only three came up with a positive match for the enzyme. One is an astronaut who's just come back from the ISS. The other is our head of IT. And the other is our expert cosmologist on the subject of the void, Jessica Johnson.
When am I going to see you again?
I don't know.
Soon?
Yeah, soon. Definitely
sooner than,
soon.
Sooner than yeah. This time.
And
okay.
I promise I will definitely text you back.
Okay. Enjoy the croissant.
I will.
I'll be
see
back
you.
About 8
or 8.
Okay.
Good luck,
Mary.
Good.
Take care.
Yeah. Obviously, you know why I'm here.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. And to be honest, I'm having some reservations myself.
Of course.
I'm coming to you sort of off the record. As a friend more than a colleague. I respect that, and I get that this is a really difficult decision for you as much as it is for me. I know that, and I want to make the right decision that I'm better going ahead with the procedure than my knowledge being here.
Mm.
But also, there's no way back.
There's no way back.
And... I'm sorry, but, excuse me. I need to make sure my family are really well cared for.
That I can guarantee.
Yeah?
I can guarantee that your family will be taken care of.
And it needs to be delicate the way you tell them.
I will be sensitive.
Thank you.
Of course. You don't need to worry about that.
This can't be for nothing. I'm aware that we've got one shot at this, and time is running out.
Yes, it is running out. It's very pressing. You know, you will go down in history books for what you potentially, if you agree to do it. Well, Jessica is faced with a very difficult decision. She is the best candidate that we have at the present time to participate in the Human 2.0 project. Of course, it's not an easy choice to make. I really don't know how to convince her to make this choice. I feel terribly conflicted because we all know that her life will change irrevocably, and there's no guarantee that she will, make it out of this process alive. It's a very big responsibility for me. And it's ultimately up to her.
I'm going to do it.
What?
It makes perfect sense. I know this mission more than anyone here. and I understand the objective. I'm the only person here who understands what could potentially be on the other side.
You don't have to do this. You're much more valuable to us down here.
Well, given the tight time frame, you know that this is the right thing to do.
Look, we'll have to run tests, and besides, we have the other two positive candidates. What makes you think
the board... astronaut, James Goodge. Firstly, just back from the ISS. Secondly, he has a family. David Jennings in IT, I mean, seriously. The guy is so defensive. Definitely not first contact material. I've already done the psych tests, and I'm cleared for the procedure.
Now, I haven't worked directly with her, but in light of recent communications, it's clear that she's volatile and, you know, frankly, a ticking time bomb. I don't think we should have someone like that lead a scientific investigation on what could possibly be the most important discovery in the history of space exploration.
She has this ability to focus and this attention that she applies to her work, which is very impressive. And she has this exploratory nature with everything that she does, always looking deeper into every anomaly that she's researching, drawing conclusions from the data, and thinking about things in a way that's very valuable and unique. And really, I think Jessica is the ideal person for this mission.
When Jessica was making her decision, she came to me to find out more about what it was going to be like in the human 2.0 body. So obviously we discussed the physical differences, but she was more concerned about her emotional capabilities. And I reassured her, this is the most important aspect to us. Preserving her emotional intelligence and inner moral compass, you know, that's what makes you human, and it's a human that we want to send up there.
Well, it's absolutely incredible what they can do. It's very overwhelming, but Alice was wonderful. She told me exactly what is entailed with the procedure. I know a bit more about it now. It's incredible. I'm ready. I absolutely have to do this. And yeah. The hardest part of this decision to go ahead with the procedure has been calling up my friends and family to just hear their voice one last time. These phone calls really made me realize the sacrifices I'm making. Even if I do survive it, I am well aware that this is a one-way mission and there is no point of return to my original life.
Fusion has been successful. We have our first human 2.0. We are literally God right now.
When I watched her eyes open and when I saw her take her first breath, it was like she was reborn. But it's like you're watching consciousness come alive right in front of you. And this unprecedented mix of human consciousness and technology.
Okay, guys, can you check on this? Hey, Jessica, just calm down. It's okay. The speech synthesizer, it needs some reconfiguration, okay? But just calm down. This isn't permanent. We can fix this, okay? But try and relax yourself. So we're having some issues with this speech synthesizer. Basically, the electrode that's implanted in the brain, which is communicating telemetrically with the neural decoder, and this is where I think we're having some issues. We need to do some reconfiguration here.
Strange, hearing my voice. I still feel like myself, but I'm just in a new body. I can feel pressure when I touch my fingertips together, but I don't have any sense of pain yet. When I look in the mirror, I see my old face, only inside a new body. Sometimes, when I close my eyes, I totally forget that I am in a synthetic body. Everything which makes me who I am, it's in my consciousness. I'm told that I will have to go through extensive rehabilitation to get my brain used to the synthetic body.
After the first time, when we lost Carl, I sometimes doubted that we'd be here today. Seeing her now, alive, it changes everything.
That's so profound. Sorry, I find it really staggering. And I suppose mixed in with that is the fact that she is a woman, a human being like you and me. And she must be wondering how it's all gonna work out as well. But I think she's gonna be just fine.
I would suggest that this is the beginning of the future of astronauts to come.
I won't deny the fact that our human 2.0 soldier may possess certain hardware attributes within its synthetic body, which will differ from the synthetic astronaut. Yes, he is carrying small arms, which is part of the human 2.0 soldier body design. You don't send a soldier on a mission without a weapon. And considering that we do not know what is behind the void, it is inherently dangerous to be unprepared.
Thank you. 3, 2, 1. Jessica, we can see what you see, over. Please commence on observation report.
Pressure stable inside the craft. It's all looking good.
Jessica, you are a go. Engaging onboard trajectory system.
We're getting closer. We're approaching the void. I can almost see it. It's almost within range. There it is. There's the void. Wow. It is beautiful.
Be advised, we're no longer receiving crest telemetry.
As we get closer, I can feel everything around me. It's starting to... Oh, the pressure is so strong. System readings are fluctuating, becoming irregular. There's some strange light coming in from all around up ahead. Oh, wow, this is incredible. The void is starting to destroy everything. Here we go.
Well, we don't know exactly when we can expect our astronauts to return. We can only speculate and hope, and I hope that they will be back, you know, within the year. But it's possible that it could take several years, several decades even. And there is also the remote possibility that we may never hear from them. We're prepared for every eventuality. We're tracking them right now. And, you know, as you can see, we're all working flat out, keeping tabs on what's going on. And everybody is listening every single second. There's been an accident. And I'm afraid that Jessica has been involved. There was an explosion on the rocket, and I'm really sorry to say, but we've lost her. Everything is dangerous, my sweet. Everything.
And why was she on it?
It's her job.
Couldn't they have put someone else on the rocket?
No, darling. No. Yeah, that was tough. My goodness. It's all very complicated. I've never lied to my daughter about anything before. And, of course, the last time I had to tell her somebody died, it was my husband. And it's not pleasant to have to go through that again. I know that, if she could know the truth and if she knew why, she would forgive me. It's hard.
This morning, one of our defense ballistic missile radar systems picked up a fast-moving object heading towards the Atlantic Ocean. We use this to track space debris, satellites.
This object, it has the same size, velocity, trajectory as the craft that we sent through into the void.
I mean, we were awestruck, that's for sure. I mean, within a few days of launching, I mean, to return so quickly.
When we arrived, we lifted the craft out of the water, and I remember smearing black residue off the side. Well, usually when you see a craft with that amount of aging, you would expect that the craft had been out for a long period of time and had a very forcible entry back into the atmosphere. From my experience from previous missions, what would happen is that you would enter the craft and there'd be two astronauts there, but in this case, the military astronaut was nowhere to be found.
We need to consider the fact that perhaps this whole void is a Trojan horse. That this could be perhaps a message, a warning.
I don't think it's a failure that it's come back in 7 days. I mean, we have something that has been through the void and come back. Now our next step is to start doing tests. As standard protocol for all our astronauts, we have to keep Miss Johnson in quarantine to prevent any form of biological contamination she may have been exposed to.
We have to prepare ourselves for the fact that the mission is a failure. What we need to do now is get ready for next steps.
To be honest, whether she wakes up is another thing. She may physically wake up now, or even next week, or next year. When patients suffer severe brain damage, then they go into a coma or vegetative state. It's possible that the sustained injury is impairing their normal brain function.
When we plugged her into the transco bay, we discovered that the recorded data in her brain showed several years worth of new memories recorded. Yet, she had only been away for 5 days.
It's possible, even probable, that the time on the void is well different from our concept of time. What is a couple of years the other side? May well just be a few days here.
The transcode process works by tapping into the connectome where the memories are stored. This is made possible by artificial intelligent chip implants installed at the side of the brain. So this helps us encode memories and also stores them as synaptic connections. What our transcoding technology does is it unscrambles this chain of synaptic connections into a stream of data. Our software then processes this stream of data as imagery. So when played back, it's incredible. It's actual memory footage.
We've transcoded bursts of memory, and although short, it's very promising. In fact, I think it's better than anybody expected. At this stage of the game, however, they are short because it's very taxing mentally for Jessica. So she needs a certain amount of time to recover for the synapses in her brain to recover from the experience that she's had, to sort of regather, as it were, and then we start again. So for me, there's a priority, obviously, which is to take care of Jessica. I certainly don't want the information that she has to be compromised in any way by pushing this process too quickly. However, there is an imperative that we get the information as soon as possible.
We have some very worried people here at Strategic Defense Committee. With the heightened activity in our skies, National Security Alert was elevated to Code Red. Now bear in mind, we have protocols set in place for this kind of event since the 40s.
Oh, yeah.
Something must have triggered her brain synapse, like a switch. Her brain activity lit up like fireworks. Ugh. Her diagnostics were normal. Nothing seemed damaged. Her brain did have a level of trauma, but that's to be expected. And her memories will take a while to reconnect. Despite my professional advice to the space agency officials, not enough time was given to allow for her recovery. There were too many questions. And everyone wanted answers.
Jessica, I'm gonna ask you some questions, and it's very important that you answer them as clearly as possible so that we can prevent confusion with the memory transcodes.
I understand.
What do you remember from the launch?
There was so much light. I remember thinking to myself that this light is going to blind me if I keep my eyes open.
Can you tell me what happened with the Soldier 2.0?
The Soldier, he remained quiet as we went into the void. But as the light flashes became more violent, I couldn't watch him. I had to close my eyes for a moment. And when I opened my eyes, I noticed that he was no longer in the craft. I looked outside, and I could see him floating away.
Jessica, sorry, can you confirm that again?
I said there was no way that he could have left the craft via the hatch. He just floated there as if frozen. He had a look of fear in his eyes, and he kept looking down at his arm. His arm exploded into a white flash of light, which looked like a nuclear bomb detonation. And then the craft began spinning out of the void and towards what looked like a planet. I must have passed out because I then found myself on the planet's surface and had no idea how that happened. I kept walking and walking. It was as if I was drawn to a specific location.
Jessica, did you make first contact?
Yes. I saw them, but they had no shape or form. I felt their presence as if they were trying to communicate to me. And then there was a flash, and I found myself inside a white environment. In the distance, something approaching me. I felt paralyzed. I just couldn't move. I know I should have been scared or terrified, but I wasn't. I actually felt calm. But he didn't physically speak. I could hear him, though, in my head, telling me that everything is going to be okay.
What are their intentions?
it was strange. I could feel what it was saying. It wasn't a voice as such. It was just information being presented into my mind.
Many in the committee are questioning the validity of Jessica's memory transcodes, in particular the appearance of astronaut Jim Marcel. They are questioning whether this is a manifestation of her imagination, a kind of mirage, if you will. However, I have to wonder why he appeared in the first place. And to me, I think it's important to perhaps examine the idea that astronaut Jim Marcel is alive and well and on the other side of the void. He's not damaged in body or mind, seemingly. So perhaps this would indicate that their intentions towards us are positive and that they mean us no harm.
We have to be extremely cautious in our response to Jessica's statements. We have to run a whole lot of tests to ascertain whether or not she's suffering from any form of post-traumatic stress. She's been through one hell of an experience. It's bound to have some side effects, even if they are temporary. We have a lot at stake here, and we can't afford to make any rash conclusions at this stage about what the transcodes are and where they come from. Are they really Jessica's own organic memories? Or are they imposed, placed there by someone or something else?
so wrong. We could not have been more wrong about all of this.
That we were so blinded by our own paranoia that we couldn't see what was really going on.
We thought that we were being attacked. It didn't occur to us in our wildest dreams that actually we were being saved. That thought never crossed my mind. And I am feeling humbled, I think, is the word that comes to mind. And, you know, you see something like this, you can't help but question everything that you think you know.
Breaking news. Today, no matter which race, religion, or political view you hold, or which wars you are fighting, everyone on this planet is witnessing a historical event, which experts are calling the cosmic event of our lifetime.
Since the event, Jessica's mind is less constricted, and more memories have been transcoded. The more we've transcoded, the more we've learned about Jessica's first contact experience with them and their intentions.
He said that this is all part of a cycle, a process created by them to keep the universe stable and working. I had to ask, why us? Why did they save us? Whatever they learned about us, perhaps made them decide that we were a species worth preserving after all, regardless of our flaws. He said their work is done, and in time they will return.
I never thought that the GAD would have played such an important part in saving humanity. And we designed it to inform extraterrestrial, intelligent life, if they bothered reading it. Well, it happened. They did.
Human beings, when faced with the unknown, there's an immediate reaction to go on the offense. You have two choices, really. Fight or flight. That was our mindset. Of course, having the military involved, that's going to be part of how we approach these things. And I think from early days, you know, the beginning of this discovery, we gradually entered onto that path of feeling that we were under threat. And I have to say, it never really crossed our minds for one single second that there was something out there that was helping us. Now, I don't know why that didn't occur to us, but maybe it's a question we need to ask ourselves. Is everything that we don't understand, is it something to be feared right off the bat as a knee-jerk reaction? Or is there space that we can make to contemplate that there could be forces out there that really are on our side? And that are part of helping us evolve.
Nothing we thought we knew about physics, science, about intelligent life, nothing that we've theorized could ever have prepared us for this. There's no physical, scientific explanation for this or why it happened.
Although the scientists and other members of the space agency are overwhelmed by this event, the Defense Department can't help but ask the question about these aliens. Is it in their best interest if the human race survives?
Every astronaut is fitted with a tracking device. So in the early hours of this morning, the military honed in on a tracking signal that was consistent with the device carried by astronaut Jim Marcel. They found him wandering around in a state of complete shock in the Arizona desert, and we have no idea how he got there. I think maybe we can assume that now that the void has disappeared, disappeared. His role as a conduit is no longer necessary. Unfortunately, Jim Marcel has no recollection of what happened to him on the other side of the void, and he will need some time to come to terms with recent events. We really have no idea what he experienced on the other side of the void.
Since the disappearance of the void and the black spheres, we've been noticing a lot of strange yet fascinating activity above our planet, an aftermath of recent events. It's a swirling cloud of gas and dust and ice could be seen, producing what appeared to be planets and their moons being pulled down into their own gravity.
It's now looking like we have a new solar system. The fact that it's actually happened, unsettling on sort of the deepest level, because it throws into question every single thing that I and my colleagues have learned about our Earth, our solar system, space, and beyond.
What resulted was the formation of a new planet right next to ours, a sister planet. Directly in our orbit. Our unmanned probes performed atmosphere and surface scans, and the resulting data indicated that this new planet has all the ingredients required to sustain human life. From surface temperature to magnetic field, water, oxygen, it was as though this planet was custom built just for us. This new planet and its mass is almost identical to our planet, with a 10% variation in size. That's why we're starting to refer to it as Earth 2. With future world populations predicted to soar above 12 billion, and resources are running out, it's impossible to accurately determine how long we'll actually sustain life here. So when a mission like this comes along, leaders of the world's nations will pay any costs to be part of this.
The arrival of Earth 2 has set off what can only be described as a 21st century gold rush. Corporations and governments alike are
quickly positioning themselves and their country's interests for our new neighboring planets. The UN has called upon all leaders from key nations to come together to discuss interplanetary strategies, which include the use of nuclear power to assist in colonization. Meanwhile, people all over the world are taking to social media to express their hopes, thoughts, and concerns.
Earth 2 is a chance to build a new life.
What I'd like to know is who's making those decisions.
Rich and politicians, they can't be the ones to make decisions about our children's future home.
I mean, what if there is life on the new Earth?
I mean, what are we going to see? What are we going to find when we go up there? We're going to absolutely destroy that planet.
Because the governments are corrupt, and we should go to Earth 2, because that way they can stay here and they can continue to fight.
I don't buy it. I think this is a mining operation. For minerals and resources.
This discovery changed everything we know about the universe and about ourselves.
Not that democracy exists anyway, right? And we should vote on the kind of people that we want to send there. The very best scientists, the very best artists, the very best philosophers, and people who actually think and care about humanity.
Well, this occurrence has opened up the Pandora's box of whys. There's also a whole host of other complicated questions. Specifically, how do we proceed? It's been 12 months since we last saw the void. Yet I have this sure feeling they haven't really left us. And if anything, they're still observing us. Today, we are sending the first manned spacecrafts to Earth 2. The space agency decided that we send only human 2.0s first, with the intention of running tests on Earth 2, in order to lay down the foundations for when the time is right to commence sending humans to settle down and colonize for future generations. One does wonder whether we will make the same mistakes we've been making for centuries. How can we ensure this new home brings out the best in us? I hope we and our future generations don't make the same mistakes we did in our past and prove that our existence was worth saving. We were so obsessed with discovering new life when, on reflection, we have still yet to discover ourselves. We now have another chance to do just that.